Hey everybody, it's Lon Sybin, and this is our monthly sponsored video from Plex, where I do a deep dive into one of its features. And I figured today we would do an update on the DVR feature because I wanted to see if we could run everything from this WD MyCloud PR2100. In other words, install the Plex server on here, have it do all of our regular media serving, but also have this work as the DVR device so we could watch live TV as well as record stuff. We're gonna see how this performs at that task. And the reason why I'm experimenting with this thing today is because I am planning on having this device replace my computer and Windows Media Center installation that I've been using now for about 4 years or so. Windows Media Center was discontinued with Windows 10. I'm still running it on an old Windows 7 laptop. The channel guides are not updating as well as they used to. There's a lot of things that are starting to unravel with this thing, and it's time to make a big transition. So this is the first step to see if the heaviest load can be put on this device and still have a workable media solution for the household here. Now, I do want to mention, in the interest of full disclosure, this is a paid sponsorship from Plex. However, they are not reviewing this content before it is posted. All the opinions you're about to hear are my own. And the WD PR2100 is on loan from WD. I should also mention that they are a past sponsor here on the channel. We're also going to talk about the HD HomeRun television tuner. They're also an occasional sponsor here on the channel as well. So with those disclosures out of the way, let's get to work. Now, I reviewed the WD PR2100 a few months ago, and the reason why I'm choosing this particular NAS device for this overall DVR project is that this is one of the few NAS devices that supports hardware transcoding in Plex. And that is a critical feature that's missing from a lot of different NAS devices out there, including many manufactured by WD. So this will, in hardware, transcode and allow multiple streams of video to be transcoded on the fly. And I covered that in my initial review, so I definitely suggest checking it out. What we're going to take a look at today is how well it handles the MPEG-2 broadcasts that will come in over the air or possibly from your cable system. We'll see how that stacks up while we're doing our testing a little later in this review. Now, the first thing you have to do here, though, is get Plex onto your MyCloud. And they do offer a version through the WD App Store that's a part of your hardware control panel here, but this is not the most current version. So this one is a couple of versions behind. I believe it does support the DVR, but it's not the most up-to-date one. So what I suggest you do is go over to the Plex website at plex.tv, and if you go over to downloads, you'll see they have a bunch of pre-packaged versions for a number of different NAS devices, and we can go and grab that real quick. So let's go over to download here, and I'm going to now select my WD NAS here. So we'll select Western Digital. They've got a bunch of others that you can get as well. And you can see here, this is the June 28th, 2017 edition, which is the newest one at the time that I am recording this video. So we're going to choose that package and select the particular NAS that we're downloading for, which is the PR2100. And what it's going to do now, hopefully, is download, there it goes, download about 120 megabytes or so to my hard drive here. And if I go back to our WD control panel, I can install that particular package manually. I think I might have to do this every time there's a new version, but I did find that Plex is keeping things up to date faster on their website than we're seeing here with the WD App Store. So there is a little link here to install an app manually, which I'm going to do now. And if we go over to my downloads folder, you can see there is a MyCloud Plex Media Server package here, about 107 megabytes, I stand corrected. I'll click OK to that, and you'll see here now it is updating, and in a second or two, this should be done, and the Plex server will be up and running on the NAS here. And what's nice about this is that it will run continuously, even if it gets rebooted. So this will boot up just like any other native WD app might. So we'll let this finish processing here and installing, and then we'll get back to it and see how to get everything working. So the app is now installed successfully. I'm going to click OK here, and this screen will refresh. And now on the left-hand side here, we should now see that there is a Plex Media Server installed. So even though we don't have the one from WD installed on here, we do have the one from Plex, and we can go in and interact with it just like we would any other app that was installed through the WD App Store. So I'm going to click on Configure now, and that's going to bring us over to the Plex configuration page running on the NAS. Now remember, in order to use the DVR features right now, you need to have a Plex Pass subscription. but all of the free features will work on here with this installation. So you can get a pretty functional Plex server running with all the hardware transcoding here without the need to get the Plex Pass, but all the advanced stuff we're going to be showing here requires that. Now, I did show how to configure the DVR in a prior video, which I'm going to link to down below. So I'm going to get this thing all set up for you, and we're going to come back and see how well it performs. So we have the DVR here set up, and everything seems to be working just like it did on my PC. So I have the HD Home Run Prime here that I use to serve live television to my network. I limited the channel guide here to just the HD channels, which is a nice feature to limit down some of the standard definition stuff. So all the HD channels are in place and ready to go. One thing that I would look to just verify on here is the transcoder section. Go over to transcoder, click on show advanced, and just make sure that hardware acceleration when available is checked on, because if you don't have this checked on, this little device won't have enough horsepower to get the transcoding done, but with this box checked, it does. I found this was enabled by default, but you just want to double check that before you get into everything. So now we've got a live broadcast here running from my PBS station. This is an MPEG-2 broadcast that is being converted via the hardware transcoder on here to H.264. I'm also recording two shows right now at the same time. So we've got three things going on here at once. We've got a live broadcast as well as two other MPEG-2 streams being recorded. I really wanted to stress this test out here and see how this thing can perform doing the sorts of things that you might have going on in your home. And it seems like the iCloud is able to keep up with that so far. I don't usually watch these two shows, but they were the only two MPEG-2 recordings I had going at the moment. I also wanted to show you the CPU utilization here as we're doing those recordings and doing the hardware transcoding for the live broadcast. CPU is at about 42% right now. It's hovering around that mark. It goes anywhere from about 30 to 50% depending on what's going on. So it is able to keep up with that live stream going on. I've also found that a number of my cable stations are now being broadcast to me in H.264, and that stresses the transcoder less. So I'm seeing less CPU utilization on those MPEG-4 broadcasts. So far it looks like it's able to keep up with everything quite well here in the house, and I'm pretty impressed with how all of that is working so far. I have noticed some artifacting on the live broadcast, but I am attributing that to my cable system. They really compress the heck out of stuff, and it's certainly visible on the high resolution screen sitting this close to it. I also ran the hardware transcoder on this using a couple of Blu-ray MKV files running at the same 1080p 20 megabit profile this is running at, and I did not see the artifacts that I'm seeing with the live broadcast, so I'm going to blame my cable company on that. I think if you're pulling things off the air, it's going to look better, but nonetheless, it is working quite well. And one of the things that I like about the iPad app here is that I can run things picture in picture, so I can run off to other apps and still have my video running on top of it. Another thing they added to the iOS applications is the ability now to do some time shifting. So you can see here I've got a big yellow bar here. This is when I started watching. I can now pause live TV. I can rewind the thing here to an earlier part of the broadcast. I can do 30-second skipping here as well. So that is something that was just recently added to the iOS app. It is not yet on the Android TV app, and I don't believe the DVR functionality at the time that I'm recording this video has yet reached the Android phone and tablet platforms, but I know that they're working on it. So we're getting some basic time shifting functionality now that was lacking on my first video with this, which was nice to see. One thing though that it does not do is time shift a recording in progress. So if, for example, I was recording this hour long show and I started watching right here at the beginning of the yellow bar, that is the extent of the time shifting I can do. So even though it's recording right now to the Plex media server, I can't rewind to the beginning of the recording until it's done. But I can work within the space that I was in when I first started watching live. A little complicated, but I'm sure at some point they'll get the rest of that figured out. So all in, it seems to be working pretty well over the Plex DVR here with the WD MyCloud. I've been impressed with it so far. I did have one crash earlier, but I haven't had one since. So I'm going to probably keep an eye on this to make sure it is working reliably, and I'll do an update if any further crashes happen. Now, my plan is actually to run both the Plex DVR and the HD HDHomerun DVR on this box together. They can actually work concurrently, which is kind of cool. And my plan is to use the HDHomerun as the recording engine, as well as the engine that drives all of my in-home television watching, but supplement things with Plex. So have Plex organize my media that the HDHomerun records, as well as act as a live TV watching functionality for a lot of my mobile devices like my iPad here. So I'm going to be experimenting with this and sharing all of those experiences with you as time goes on here. But at least at the moment, we do have the Plex media server running successfully with its DVR application on this MyCloud PR2100. I'm going to put a link down below with a list of hardware compatibility for Plex hardware transcoding. Right now, I think, and I might be wrong, but at this price point, this one starts at around $400. This is probably the least expensive NAS with hardware transcoding that's out there right now. You do have to put disks in it, so decked out with a 4 terabyte mirrored configuration, you're looking at about $600 or $700. So not totally inexpensive, but I think less expensive than getting a PC going to do the same task. So we'll keep playing with this and see where it goes. If you know of other NAS devices that are compatible, definitely leave me some comments down below. But at the moment, I think this one is probably the best price to performance ratio I'm seeing at the moment for Plex hardware transcoding. And that'll do it for this one. This is Lon Seibin. Thanks for watching.
This channel is brought to you by my Patreon supporters, including Gold Level supporter Cody Falk. If you want to help the channel, you can by contributing as little as $1 a month. Head over to Lon.TV/Patreon to learn more. And don't forget to subscribe. Visit Lon.TV/S.